Good afternoon and welcome everyone to the Perinatal Depression Research Engagement webinar series. We are so excited that you're taking time out of your day to join us here for this session. We know that we have attendees from across the world and we are just thrilled to spend this time with you today. For this first series, we are going to be featuring researchers from Canada. And we are going to learn much about patient-centered outcomes research that relates to both US problems, but then problems that we're seeing in clinics globally. As a point of acknowledgement, I would first like to thank our funders for this program. That is the Patient-Centered Research Outcomes Institute. I will be moderating today. My name is Dr. Karen Tabdina. I'm an associate professor of social work at the University of Illinois. I've provided my email contact in case you would like to reach out after the series for any questions that might come up or future communications. In terms of how I identify for this project, I'm a researcher. I've been doing health services research for the past 12 years, but more recently in the past 8 years, I've become a patient for issues pertaining to perinatal mental health, pregnancy health, and minority mental health. So I hold those roles dearly. Our speakers today are well-rounded and brilliant. We start first with Courtney Clyatt. She's a senior program officer at PCORI. She right now works in the Eugene Washington Engagement Awards portfolio. Prior to transferring to the Eugene Washington Awards, she oversaw the pipeline to proposal programs, the P2P programs, which our group knows quite well, and we are so grateful to have her here. Our next featured speaker is Dr. Daisy Singla. She is a clinician scientist at the Department of Psychiatry at Sinai Health, the Mount Sinai Hospital, and the University of Toronto. She is a clinical psychologist by training and a global health researcher at heart. And last but not least, we have Kerr Zlobin. She founded Life with a Baby in 2008, a peer support program connecting women to mental health resources in and around Ontario. This came to be after her own experience with postpartum anxiety and depression. Since then, Claire has emerged as a pivotal advocate to broker change in the recognition and treatment and stigma of maternal mental health. I know on a webinar series, we can't clap, but we can clap at heart as we look forward to our speakers. As a point of housekeeping before we get started, on this conferencing platform, we cannot see your speaker. We cannot hear your speakers or see your camera. So this is a point where you can relax and enjoy the webinar series and rejoin through the chat mechanism. I encourage you, if you have questions that come up, to use the question and answer box found in the communication ribbon to type in any questions that you might have. If you are typing into the chat box, the panelists will be able to see your chats, but other participants won't. So we will move those chats to the Q&A if they're not confidential, of course. With that being said, I would like to turn it over to Courtney Clyatt as she's prepared a presentation for us.
Hello, and thank you for that introduction, Karen, and thank you to the team who's made this pivot to a virtual convening possible. I'm pleased to speak with you today and tell you a bit more about the Patient-Centered Outcomes Research Institute, as well as patient-centered outcomes research and what makes it different from the traditional research paradigm. And I'll also share a bit more with you about our growing maternal health portfolio. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. All right, next slide, please. All right, thank you. So first I'll start by telling you a bit more about PCORI, where I work, and I'll get into basically our founding as an independent, non-profit, non-governmental organization founded or authorized by Congress in 2010. As an organization, we were reauthorized in 2019, and we fund comparative clinical effectiveness research, that engages patients and other stakeholders throughout the research process. It also supports work that will improve the methods used to conduct such research, like patient and stakeholder engagement. So for all the advances that it produces, traditional healthcare research has not always answered many of the questions that patients face. And we want people to know and have an understanding of what is the best option for them. Next slide, please. Thank you. So patients and their clinicians need information that they can understand and also use. And PCORI seeks to support those efforts focused on answering some of those questions. And in these efforts, we seek to answer real-world questions and those that work, answering questions related to those that work best for patients given their circumstances. And also, I understand that we may have some attendees from outside of the U.S., and I wanted to make sure that you're aware that foreign organizations can apply to PCORI for funding if there is a demonstrable need or benefit to the U.S. healthcare system. And then also, one of the other key issues is to ensure that the engagement plan that will be used in that project will include U.S. patients and stakeholders, and that that project idea is relevant to the U.S. healthcare system. Next slide, please. All right, so as I mentioned before, PCORI works to answer patients' questions, and so patients may sometimes ask what they should expect will happen to them if they take a specific medication or they use a specific diagnostic treatment. They may also question what options are best for them and what are the potential benefits and harms of those options that are presented to them in a healthcare setting. They may also wonder like how what they can do to improve the outcomes that are important to them. And then also their clinicians may need information that helps them to make the decision of what's best for them in their healthcare. Next slide, please. So PCORI pays close attention to conditions that heavily burden patients, families, and or the healthcare system. We focus our funding on chronic and or multiple conditions, rare and understudied conditions, and then also conditions with varied outcomes across subpopulations. Next slide, please. So this next slide, I wanted to share with you a new resource that PCORI has made available on our website. It is the Research Fundamentals Learning Package. It's a training that you can, as I mentioned, find on our website, and it allows you to move at your own pace. And the next few slides show you just a sense of some of the screenshots of what you could see. So there are 5 interactive learning modules, and those modules provide foundational knowledge for PCORI and CER. And this here shows you those 5 modules. So developing research questions, designing a research study, sampling, recruiting, et cetera. Next slide, please. So in this next set of slides, I'll be sharing a bit more with you about our growing research portfolio. And so as you can see on this map here, we have awards that we've funded in 49 of 50 states, including DC, the District of Columbia, and Puerto Rico. So the state that we have that hasn't received any funding just yet is North Dakota. So if we have anybody who's participating in this webinar who's from North Dakota and or has partners in North Dakota, we would certainly love to receive some applications from you all. All right, so we've funded 1,700 projects for more than $2.8 billion. And this slide here just shows you some of the heavily funded healthcare areas. And so you can see the primary condition is mental and behavioral health, and then also cancer is the number 2 condition. And as I mentioned before, we have a high priority on conditions that affect large numbers of people, that place a heavy burden on individuals and society, as well as rare diseases, which may be difficult to study. Next slide, please. So thus far, we've funded about $57 million in CER studies or comparative clinical effectiveness studies. related to maternal health. So out of that $57 million, there are 18 studies on maternal health. And next slide. This slide shows a little bit more about our evolution as we are trying to bring more voices into the maternal health forum. So this past year, or last year, as I mentioned, PCORI was reauthorized, and in that reauthorization, we received a new national priority. So maternal health became, or maternal mortality, I should say, along with morbidity, became a national priority, also along with intellectual and developmental disabilities. And so as a result of that, we are in recent times, we had a recent funding opportunity that was made available where there was special emphasis put on projects that we received for maternal mortality, as well as intellectual and developmental disabilities. So PCORI is continuing to engage with Congress and other stakeholder organizations to ensure that we can hear the important voices and bring them into the discussion. Back in the fall of 2019, there was a multi-stakeholder maternal mortality salon, which Karen actually took a part in. And then we've also had a listening session with the Black Maternal Health Caucus. And we recently had scheduled to have a maternal mortality stakeholder meeting. However, that was put on hold pretty much because of the pandemic that we're all going through right now. Our hope is that the information that we hear in having these conversations and making a space to hear from stakeholders in maternal mortality will allow us to have a better understanding of the current landscape, and then also continue to build relationships and identify new voices. Next slide, please. So before I close, I wanted to give you all an opportunity to see what options we have for you to become involved with PCORI. We have our advisory panels, we have the ambassador program, merit review. We also have an engagement tools and resources repository. We also have peer review. And on the last slide here, and my understanding is that the next slide, please. The slides will be shared with you. There are links to these individual things that I've just mentioned for you to explore at your leisure. And so with that, I'll close and thank you for your time. If there are any questions, I am available to do my best to try and answer those.
Thank you so much for that, Courtney Clyatt. Fabulous introduction from PCORI, and hopefully others are just as excited as we are about the continuing support and opportunities to really try and ameliorate the problems that we're seeing in our clinics and the populations that we're concerned with birthing peoples in this country. I have a quick poll for everyone in the room. If you could please respond, we'd like to see who's in the room. So which group do you identify most with? Patient, provider, researcher, policymaker? Let's take a stab at this poll. It looks like the polling has slowed. We're almost there. We're receiving poll responses in the chats as well, where folks are saying, I am a clinician, but I'm also a patient. or I am a patient, or I'm a provider, mental health provider. It looks like we have a nice spread of researchers, clinicians, advocates, community-based organizations, patients, providers, even policymakers. And we are missing payers in this particular conversation, but maybe folks will join late, and health system administrators as well are missing today. Well, thank you for participating in the poll. This is so nice to see who's in the room. I would like to turn it over now to both Daisy and Claire to provide some of their background information for the project that they've embarked upon and why they do the work that they do. Thank you both.
All right. Hello, everyone. My name is Daisy Singla, and I am very pleased to be here today. Thank you so much, Karen, for having us. This is certainly a unique opportunity to present to all of you in this type of a forum. So bear with me as I present on Zoom. I wish we could meet in person. I do hope that we meet in person in due course. I'm here to talk about my journey alongside my colleague, my cherished colleague, Claire, who serves as a stakeholder on our larger project called Summit. And I will speak about Summit, but before I speak about Summit, I think it's worthwhile to provide you with an introduction. So I am a Canadian, and my parents were born in India. They came here back in the 70s. And I was born and raised in Canada. I spent a lot of the last decade in low and middle income countries. And I moved back to North America, basically to get a job and to pursue a career and a passion in maternal mental health. So as Karen had mentioned, I am a clinician scientist in the Department of Psychiatry, and I'm a clinical psychologist as well as a global health researcher. And before I get to global health research, some of you may be familiar with global health as a discipline, but I do want to mention that. The thing that really inspires me is maternal mental health. I've been working on this topic, believe it or not, for the last 15 years. And one thing for sure is that women across the world are not getting the treatments that we know that work, including psychological treatments, which are recommended as the first line of treatment to address the significant burden of depression, anxiety, and stress-related disorders worldwide. And they remain inaccessible for the wide majority of people in the world, including perinatal populations in Canada. So that is the driver behind what I'm doing, but I'll try to describe this in so much more detail. So high-income countries such as Canada, 1 in 5 women may have access to minimally adequate treatments, whereas 1 in 20 women in low- and middle-income countries, such as places that I've worked in India, Bangladesh, Pakistan, and most many countries across Eastern Africa, the rates are a little bit lower. Regardless, in my opinion, this is not justifiable. And so I've devoted my life to addressing the access issue that we know is prominent worldwide. I don't think this is news to probably most of this group to say that perinatal depression and anxiety affects 1 in every 5 women. In fact, some may argue that this is an underestimate, and that most pregnant women, as well as postpartum women, would prefer to engage in individual psychotherapy. However, as I mentioned before, the wide majority do not have access to these therapies. And this is just a few of the common barriers that were reported in some of the populations that we had interviewed across Toronto, Chapel Hill, and Chicago as primary barriers to actually accessing psychological treatments. Again, this is probably no surprise to this group here, but cost often comes as the first. Access to specialist care. There simply are not enough specialists to provide access to for women who experience depression and anxiety. Navigating the healthcare system, whether you're in Canada or the US or somewhere where a fragmented healthcare system exists, is an issue worldwide. There is no perfect healthcare system, and we encounter this problem in Canada as well. Transportation and childcare are frequently things that we hear from perinatal women across the board. And this was obvious, these barriers were commonly reported pre-pandemic, and I'll get to telemedicine interventions in a moment. So one solution that I've explored among many colleagues around the world have explored is the idea of training non-mental health specialists to deliver psychological treatments. There is a huge and growing evidence, there's a huge and growing evidence base demonstrating that non-specialist providers can effectively deliver manualized treatments for mental common mental disorders in developing countries. And what do I mean by a non-mental health specialist? Well, basically, this is anyone who provides mental health care without formal training or who has a specialized degree. So neither Karen or myself would be would fall into the category of non-mental health specialist. But we know that this works, and this includes health volunteers, peers, community health workers, teachers, nurses, and the list goes on, and it really depends on the context that you're in. So in some of the studies that I've worked in, for example, a recent study in India and Pakistan for perinatal depression, we trained peers because that was the group of individuals that was most preferred by the community and by relevant stakeholders. They were the nominated group to target issues of maternal mental health. Whereas a non-mental health specialist here in North America, it may be more appropriate to train a nurse or a midwife. And that's exactly what we're doing in the study that I'll be describing called Summit in a few slides. I want to introduce the concept of global mental health for those of you who may not be as familiar with this discipline. And this has really shaped me as an individual, myself as a researcher, and really all of what I do. So global mental health is more formally defined as the discipline of research and practice that places a priority on improving mental health and achieving equity for all people worldwide. And equity is really the driving factor here. And it's for that reason that stakeholders play such a critical role in everything that we do. And it was no surprise to involve stakeholders in our current study, because without stakeholders, we cannot do this research. I was so pleased, actually, when PCORI had asked me to put together a plan to involve stakeholders and a diverse group of stakeholders, because I can't imagine people doing this research without it. So in my mind, I would say that there's three key principles to global health and that to this patient-centered discipline, and that involves shared decision-making, empowering women and communities, and a foundation of stakeholders. And I've had the good fortune of working with many NGOs across the world, but one of the ones that I treasure the most is an NGO called Singla. They're located in Goa in India. And I've learned a lot of what I've learned in terms of stakeholder engagement through my work with this NGO. For example, the intervention that I mentioned in India and Pakistan, where peers were the preferred individual to deliver these this manualized treatment for perinatal depression, was something that we revealed in this work, working with Singla. And effectively, this was published in a paper in Journal of Affective Disorders, if you're interested. And one of our stakeholders had said that we would like someone like us to deliver mental health care in these two very diverse contexts of semi-urban Goa and rural Rawalpindi, Pakistan. But I want to hone in on not just global mental health as something that's abroad, but global mental health as something that's local. And this is something that I've spent the last few years really emphasizing. So non-mental health specialists have so frequently people have thought of this as something that's being done abroad. But we know that this is something that is being implemented in North America and in many high-income countries, as indicated by a recent review that we conducted on just perinatal mental health. So there is a huge and growing evidence base to demonstrate that not only are non-mental health specialists delivering psychological treatments in high-income countries, but indeed they are effective. And like I said, in the studies that we have identified, the majority came from Australia, the US, the UK, and Canada. And the majority involved training midwives and nurses. And when I say midwives and nurses, I'm referring to non-psychiatric nurses involved in this process. Similarly, there is a split between delivering psychosocial therapies and psychological treatments. The wide majority have been tested and evaluated through a randomized control trial have been delivered face-to-face. And the main reason for why this particular cadre of non-specialist provider was selected, or at least according to the authors, was because they reflected the existing healthcare and community setting. And I'll get to that in a moment. I want to speak a little bit about telemedicine, which does not seem as innovative now with everyone, including ourselves at the present moment using Zoom. But at the time, when we were developing our idea of Summit, which is the name of our trial and I'll come back to, basically we realized that there was huge potential in telemedicine, particularly for perinatal populations, given all the challenges there are in actually receiving and accessing in-person sessions. And that there was a lot of potential to potentially test this as it relates to in-person sessions. And so I could speak about my journey for quite a while, but basically it gave me a lot of time to think. I wanted to think about how could these lessons that we've implemented successfully abroad be implemented in a high-income country context like Canada and the US? How could we use and improve accessibility to evidence-based psychological treatments that we know that are effective and preferred by perinatal women? Who would deliver these treatments and where would they best be delivered? So I spent a few months of my first job putting together an LOI, a letter of interest to PCORI, to exactly the funding schemes that Courtney had mentioned, the clinical effectiveness research trials. And the first time I put it in, I did not involve any US sites. But the second time we put it in, we did, and we were successful. And that was the birth of Summit. So I'm going to spend the next little bit talking about Summit. So Summit stands for Scaling Up Maternal Mental Health Care by Increasing Access to Treatment. And this is funded by PCORI. And you heard a little bit about PCORI from Courtney during the introduction. And so I'm not going to go over that. But one thing that I really appreciated about PCORI, or actually two things, was an emphasis on improving the health and well-being of patients and their families, and the emphasis, the expectation that you involve stakeholders. This is an expectation and something that's not negotiable. And I just thought that this was very forward-thinking for a funder to emphasize in a way that they were very serious about. And so, like I said, we were funded by the Clinical Pragmatics Effectiveness, scheme, which really focuses on real-world settings and sustainability. So we got the good news in December 2018, and our study officially kicked off in June 2019. And I'm proud to say that the study has continued despite COVID, and we've continued successfully in terms of the study that I'm about to describe to you. So I hadn't realized that there are many trials called Summit. I thought we were being so innovative at the time, but we are yet another trial that is called Summit, and I think that this title is quite appropriate for reasons that I hope will become clear as I describe our study. So a bit of background on our study. We are a huge team, and I'm proud to say that we have stakeholders across the board to represent our study and to inform our study, both in terms with regards to various aspects of where we're at. The study is being implemented in three cities, Toronto, Chapel Hill, and Chicago, and across five sites. And to date, from what I know or from what I've seen, we will be the largest psychotherapy trial for perinatal populations. We are five PIs representing five recruitment sites. So I work closely alongside my co-PI, Samantha Meltzer-Brody at the University of North Carolina, as well as Richard Silver, who's an obstetrician. Samantha Meltzer-Brody, as some of you may know, is a perinatal psychiatrist. Simone Bigot is also a perinatal psychiatrist, and Cindy Lee Dennis is a nurse by training and has a PhD in epidemiology. So it is an extremely interdisciplinary group that represents Summit. And this is just a few of our team members, including Claire on the far left-hand side, who represent our project. But as I said before, we are a large and growing team. This picture unfortunately doesn't represent everyone in the group, but hopefully one day we will all be together. So the main questions of our study is to examine whether a brief behavioral activation-based psychotherapy delivered through telemedicine is as effective as the same in-person treatment. We also want to know whether non-specialist providers, in our case, nurses and midwives, can deliver this treatment as effectively as specialists. So I'm not too sure how many researchers are on the call, but this is a non-inferiority design, which basically examines relative efficacy in these two groups. There's a number of secondary questions that we're asking, including examining how can we basically make this as optimal as possible by examining the underlying processes related to delivery and scalability. And I'm happy to go into some of those more detail. I'm happy to go into details related to that during the Q&A. So effectively, women who are recruited to the study, and I'll get to eligibility criteria in a moment, are randomized to one of four arms. And so that would be telemedicine specialist, telemedicine non-specialist, in-person specialist, and in-person non-specialist. And everyone gets the same treatment. Everyone gets the same 6 to 8 session treatment. And it's delivered, as I said, in three cities, or what we call hubs, or across five sites. Our inclusion-exclusion criteria, in my opinion, as a researcher, is pretty wide. We want to try to, we have a huge sample of 1,368 women, half of which we anticipate to come from Canada, and half of which we anticipate to come from the US. But the reason why we have this exclusion criteria here is because behavioral activation, or the treatment that we're using, is not suitable for things like psychosis or mania, or for perinatal loss. And so it was very important for the funder to implement a treatment that has been shown to be effective and appropriate for who we were trying to target. And so we're recruiting adult women during both the who are pregnant or postpartum, and we're also recruiting women who speak English in our Canadian context or English and Spanish in our US context. You might be asking why behavioral activation, and I could probably speak a lot about behavioral activation, but effectively it's a 6 to 8 session treatment. It's brief. It's known to have a strong evidence base. It's as effective as longer courses of treatment, including cognitive behavioral therapy, as well as antidepressants. It's effective for our key population, which is target disorders, perinatal depression and anxiety. And possibly most importantly, it's easy to learn, or at least we've trained a whole cadre of non-mental health specialists in this treatment. I want to talk about the stakeholders who are involved in this group, because I would say that similar to our work in global mental health, they do form the foundation of this study. And I purposely put mothers and their families at the center of this of these circles. Because similar to my work in global mental health, I can't imagine doing this work without the perspectives of mothers and their families informing what we do, correcting what we do, and ultimately scaling up what we do. Us researchers play sort of a side role. We're implementing this study, but really the foundation of this study, and I'm probably going to emphasize this more than once, are the mothers and families involved. Similarly, clinicians and a wide range of clinicians play an integral role to our study. So you saw that our site PIs represent an interdisciplinary group, but we have a wide range of clinicians, from obstetricians to psychiatrists to psychologists to nurses to midwives, family practitioners, who play a really important role in informing the study. We have a few policymakers, but if there are any policymakers on the call today, do let me know if you're interested in Summit. We would love to incorporate you as part of our study team if there's good synergy, as we're looking to ultimately scale this up when we complete the study. The roles of stakeholders really vary depending on their expertise, but I would say they basically fall in informing three stage processes of this trial. So during development, individuals like Claire and Jamie Charlebois, who I think I saw on the list and who's on the call, who's a nurse practitioner, really inform the intervention content of our study. Is what we're delivering actually appropriate for our target population? And so, we had individuals review the manuals to see, is our intervention content relevant? Is it acceptable? Is it feasible? How should we go about selecting delivery agents or non-specialist providers? How should we recruit them? What would be the best way to excite people about this project? And very much talking about recruitment pathways from a patient-centered lens. And I should say that what we do, clearly, because we're funded by PCORI, but everything that we do does try to have a foundation of patient-centeredness. In terms of implementation, coming from a global mental health lens, diversity and equity is something that we are very focused on. I feel that so far we have managed to recruit 54% of our participants are non-white. And I think that's extremely important, particularly because of the access issue for ethnic minorities. And individuals like Claire and others have played a really important role in terms of how we can ensure that our populations are diverse from an ethnicity lens and other lenses as well. And again, ensuring that our intervention content remains centered, patient-centered. We have currently stopped our telemedicine session. We have currently stopped our in-person sessions, as you can imagine. Everyone who is being randomized, everyone who is consenting to the trial is only being randomized to the telemedicine arm. And so one of the ongoing conversations that we're having with many stakeholders in group and individual situations is how we should go about resuming in-person sessions. And that's a really important, it's such an important topic, not only to address the research question, but to ensure that, again, we're doing this from a patient-centered lens. There's been really interesting solutions that have come up with regards to how we can ensure the well-being and safety of our patients if we are to resume in-person sessions in the near or far future. Some of those solutions are site-specific, and some of them are solutions that we will be implementing. So hopefully I'm giving some examples of where stakeholders are involved in this study. And clearly in terms of dissemination, so we have so many different individuals who work and collaborate with so many different organizations. And so whether it is currently as we have this project up and running, or equally important, if not more important, when we do have our primary results, I'm sure our stakeholders will play a critical role in disseminating those results to their local, national, and international collaborators. And I want to end on this only because this is certainly, Nelson Mandela is certainly one of my heroes. But one of the things that I've learned the most through this journey of Summit, but also as a global mental health researcher, is the importance of context. It is easy as a researcher, as a clinical psychologist who has spent a lot of my life in school to forget the importance of context and language. And I read this quote, I think, when I was first 17 or 18, and it stuck with me since. I think if we do more of this, and we continue to implement research from a patient-centered and stakeholder-focused lens, I think our research practices will only be better. I think our health, our interventions will be better. And I think that there's a lot of potential to engage many of you in the kind of research that we do. So I'm going to hand it over to Claire to take it from here. So over to Claire.
I'm Claire. This is my family. And I always start off with a picture of my family because I'm on this journey because of my experience with postpartum anxiety first, followed by depression when my daughter Caitlin was born. And I like to show that, you know, obviously I found a way to thrive through supports and therapy, and subsequently had a second one. And I love to tell people that with my second, I didn't end up having any perinatal mood and anxiety disorder symptoms, because I do like to share the story of hope. I know that a lot of times families may choose not to attempt the journey a second time because of that fear that it will happen again. And sometimes it does, but sometimes it doesn't. And I do think that the aspect of peer support, of having a circle of support, made a huge difference in my experience. And I think that that's important for families to hear. So this is my family, and my story started with Caitlin. Next slide. So after Caitlin was born, I had a very traumatic birth experience, and I know that what I started off with was PTSD. I didn't know that then. I knew nothing about postpartum mood and anxiety disorders, and in my culture specifically, it wasn't something that we talked about. So for many, 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 many months, I didn't really tell anyone what I was going through, and I essentially suffered in silence. I actually only ended up getting support because I was having breastfeeding challenges, and the nurse that came to see me because of breastfeeding said to me, "I think you may have postpartum depression." I looked at postpartum depression at the time, and none of the symptoms were resonating with me, because at the time I absolutely adored my daughter. I was completely in love with her. And I thought that she was the best part of my whole experience. However, I used to have debilitating anxiety. I thought that somehow something that I did would somehow harm her in some way, accidentally falling down the stairs. I was nervous to go for walks, and I'm a nature person. I love being outdoors, but for weeks I wouldn't go for walks outside because I was worried that someone would come in from the forest, steal her out of the stroller, and run away with her. And, you know, now I know that that was postpartum anxiety, but I didn't know it then. And after months of really living like this, of living in fear, of living with anxiety and not talking to anyone about it, I ended up developing postpartum depression. So then I was struggling with two illnesses. I did eventually get into a program in York Region called Transition to Parenting, where I met other moms who were going through the same thing, and I realized I wasn't alone, which was amazing. However, when I left the program, I actually started feeling worse. And I realized it was that once I graduated out of the program from doing so well, I then again became very isolated. I didn't really have anyone to really talk to. And I realized the importance of peer support. I went online and I saw from like Best Start Health Nexus and a few other places that peer support actually prevents postpartum depression. And so I started calling agencies and I said, well, why isn't anyone doing this? Why isn't there a group? Why can't we get moms to host stroller walks and things like that? And then the response to me was always, there's no funding for it, or, you know, there's not much evidence based programs that have done it before, so there's no pilot. And that made me really angry. So Life with the Baby actually started from that place of anger, that I was so frustrated. And I'm a math person. Before all of this, I was working as an accountant, and I just said, well, if we know based on research that's already out there that peer support helps, well, I'm going to start. So I started just a group, and I just said, you know, I had my baby and this is how I'm feeling, and does anyone else relate? And within a year, 175 moms had joined this little group that I created. And by then I was feeling well and I was fine. And I was debating whether or not to go back to work. And I had to make that very difficult decision of, do I just leave now that I'm better? Or do I continue this and see if it's something that can help other families? And so I decided that I would start a nonprofit. So we first started with the Life with a Baby Foundation. And I wanted it to be something that was free, that anyone could participate. So I set it up as a nonprofit. And a year later, I set it up as a charity. And then I applied to a local program here to develop the program. I received a grant at that time called the New Agency Development Fund, which was just amazing because it allowed me to develop the program in the way that I wanted it to. And then the reason I show this picture is, you know, this may have started with me and my story, but obviously it resonated with other women who were going through the same thing. And my goal was to empower other people to see that they could do the exact same thing that I did. You know, it was really just sharing my story and saying, you know, this happened to me, but I got better, and empowering other women to do the same. So this was, I think, last year. We had a training with our community managers. Not everyone was able to make it, but essentially just training them on running programs across Canada. So I know that Karen had mentioned Ontario. So we did start the program in Ontario because this is where I live, but the program quickly grew across Canada. So it is a national program, and it is 100% based on the idea of moms supporting other mothers. We do run programs, or we have started programs for dads, but we really focus it on working with organizations that already support dads, because the whole point of it is peer support. So for this presentation, I will be focusing primarily on maternal mental health, because that's what our foundation focuses on. So the idea is that just because something didn't happen to you doesn't mean that you can't care about it and you can't empathize with that experience. So not all the moms experience postpartum depression, not all the moms experience postpartum anxiety, but they went through different aspects of transition into parenting and they could relate. One of the first programs that we started was our newcomer program. So we run programs in different languages, and I actually met the community manager for our Chinese program, which we run in both Cantonese and Mandarin, because we understand that there are cultural differences in the communities, even though the language is similar, written. And I actually met her in the elevator at a church that I was running a program in, because I just said to her, well, you know, like, what do you do for newcomers? And she said, well, there's nothing really there. And I said, well, do you want to start a group? You know, you speak Chinese. I can just tell you what to do and you can replicate it. And I remember we were speaking at a conference, a national conference in Toronto, and someone said, well, how did you start a Chinese program if you don't speak Chinese? And to me, that was like an odd question, because I don't speak Chinese, but there are other people in my community who do. And the whole point to me is collaborating and working with each other, using the strengths of other people to help the communities. It doesn't have to be just what you know. I really believe in that idea of collaborating. So next slide, please. So this is another group photo. So this is a few of our community managers with their families, because one of the things that we like to do is support our supporters. So once a year, we would have a training and a retreat for the families who run our chapters. So we have 72 chapters, but those are primarily led by about 26 women and their families. And so what we do is we have a 3-day retreat, which 2 days is really for the families to just get together and meet each other, and also for the dads to get together and, you know, learn about other families. But the idea is that the moms that are supporting families, they have families of their own, and the partners are a really big part of helping and supporting their spouse, for the ones that are in a couple relationship, to do that work, right? So it really is like a whole family support, and we wanted to recognize and support our supporters. We think that is so important. And one of the biggest trainings that we do is on vicarious trauma, because we wanna protect the supporters and ensure that they're not re-triggering themselves. Next slide. Okay, so my role on Summit is a patient advocate. And so this is me and Caitlin. This is Caitlin at 5 months. And outwardly, I was very happy. And like I said, I was extremely just totally in love with this little thing, you know, and I was so happy to have her. But in my head, I was so scared. I was so afraid. When my husband left for work in the mornings, I sometimes would be terrified. And I've spoken about this before, but one of the times that I realized that I really needed help was I brought everything that I needed for the day downstairs on the main floor. So, you know, diapers, like everything that I needed so that I wouldn't have to risk going up the stairs. And so outside, I was fine. I was very high functioning. I was also developing the Life with a Baby program at this time. But internally, I just was struggling so hard and I didn't know what was going on. And I didn't know that other people were going through it. And a lot of the stories that I saw online were, it seemed like this was something that other people had, but then they had gotten over it. And I was just, you know, a late to the party type of person. And keep in mind, at that time, there was no Facebook. So there wasn't all these, you know, groups and things like that. And I really did feel quite alone. I have to say, I was 27 years old. We had just moved into our new home. I was very happy in my marriage. You know, like there was no outward reason for me to have had this illness. And oftentimes people will say to me, you know, like you've always been so good at taking the initiative. You know what to do. So no one really checked in on me to see how I was doing, because I was the person that was usually fine. So they expected me to be fine. And I didn't know I could tell anyone how I was feeling until I started talking to other moms and they started saying, yeah, no, I feel this way too. And there's nothing so relieving as to hear from another mom that I'm going through this too. And for me to hear from other people who said, I went through this, and I'm okay, I came out, this is what I did. Or to talk to me about the idea of it's okay to go for therapy, and you know, just someone to say, I've been there, you can get through it, and this is a path. These are some of the steps that you can take. So when Daisy had initially sent the email, I think it was like 3 years ago, maybe the initial email, to see if I wanted to be a part of this, I was like, yes, absolutely, because this to me is how I feel about peers. I fully believe in the idea of using simple interventions to look at how we can solve complex problems. So we know that peer support helps. We know that some of these interventions that Daisy already mentioned helped. And I think we were really looking at literature and not implementing them. So I was just so happy to see that there was someone that was going to be taking a look at this and implementing it on a larger scale and then putting research behind it. So I was extremely happy to be a part of that. And that's why I'm a part of the Summit team. Daisy, next slide. So this quote, never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has. To me, this really embodies what Life with a Baby is about, what the overall arching theme of anyone who works in maternal mental health and supporting families and parents is about. Because we are always looking at collaborating with each other, learning from each other, reaching out to each other and say, how can we work together? And whether that is a small group or small in the grand scheme of our universe, when we work together, we make a difference. And I really do feel like this is what Summit is, and this is what Life with a Baby and other peer support groups are about. And so I just wanted to share that with you. This is a big part of kind of our guiding principles. Next slide, please, Daisy. Okay, so how do I participate in Summit? So like Daisy said, I help with patient recruitment, ensuring that the voices of those who are marginalized, who are living in fear, who are in multicultural communities where postpartum depression might be, you know, a cause for divorce, for those who feel like they can't say their challenges openly, ensuring that those voices are heard. And I really feel that ensuring that all the different multicultural communities, especially in Canada, where the Life of the Baby program is, and then the US, we're such a diverse community, just ensuring that all those voices are heard and incorporated into a part of the research. And then just having discussions on, you know, sometimes I love to play the devil's advocate because breaking down barriers is super important. Sometimes we can take a look at it from the outside perspective of, okay, we're going to do a group, but how are we going to get the moms there? And what if their baby is ill? And, you know, just all these different aspects are really participate by ensuring that the peer voice is heard. And also just through our database, we have over 70,000 families participating, so we can get the message out and get more families connected into the research. Next slide, please. Okay, so I believe that research is really an act of kindness, because when we participate in research, we make it possible to know more about the illness and to know more about things that work. And by doing that, we make it possible so that the birth of a baby is no longer the reason that we lose a life. And I think that is so important. I think that without research to show actively what works, and to show you know, funders and other investors that this is something that we can do that actually save lives, then we won't get to move the needle quite as far as we want. So I really do encourage that collaboration through research. As a peer, you have such a strong voice. Your lived experience is you are an expert. And I think a lot of times we'll say to ourselves, oh, I'm just a mom. No, you are not a mom. You are a survivor, and your story and the path that you took could be the path that another mom takes that helps them to make it out. So I just wanted to share that.
Thank you. Thank you so much for this presentation. I want to make sure that we have time to get to several of the questions that have come up in the chat box and the Q&A box. I would ask all participants to please share any questions that you might have in the Q&A box, because not everyone can see if you place it in the chat box. As a reminder, for next week, we will have another session, same place, same time, next Thursday at 4 p.m. Eastern, where we will be embarking on the topic of maternal mortality, death, and morbidity, sickness. We have three very dynamic speakers. We hope that if you haven't registered already, you register, that you complete the evaluation form, and that you help us with promotion. Please tell your friends, tell your family, tell your pastor, tell your boss, tell everyone you can about this series. And this is how we make change happen, as you heard Claire mention. With that being said, let's move into some Q&A. And get down to it. There's several questions in the chat box. The first one that I would like to pull out is from Megan Deacon Hansen from Florida State University College of Medicine. She has a question for Dr. Singla. In studies in which you've used peers for behavioral health care, how did you identify the peers with appropriate skills and or social capital?
Yeah, great question. So it frequently depends, and I was referring to a study that was implemented in India and Pakistan. And we've conducted others in Uganda as well. So in India and Pakistan, the peers were identified actually by the community itself, the communities themselves. And it was so important to get the community buy-in to determine who those women would be. And there are certain characteristics that we were looking for. So for example, in Goa, we looked for one of the things that did not matter was the age of the woman, simply that she had been, that she was a mom or has been a mom. And that was extremely important for the participant groups and the stakeholders that we were involved with. Whereas in Pakistan, it was important that those women were older because it was more rural of a setting. And so it really depended on the context, but the way that we recruited them was through advertisement. It was basically done through the community, through advertisement, through word of mouth. And this is typically the way that we recruit in these types of settings. I hope I've answered your question.
I think that was a very well-rounded response to that question. I think you could give a whole talk in just your response, am I right?
Absolutely.
If you're able to review the chat, we have many different comments and just reactions, especially to Claire's presentation. Heartfelt comments. People were really moved by what you shared and said it was a similar experience. There were some questions related to the inclusion of the stakeholders involved in the study. Mm-hmm. So one comment says, you've indicated that the diversity for patients, will providers be as diverse as well?
Great question.
The second part to it is, how will you incorporate specific stressors that women from different racial and ethnic groups experience?
Yeah, it's certainly come to life over the last 6 months. And we've actually had an explicit focus on issues of race and diversity and ethnicity that we simply, I cannot imagine if we were not exploring this. So let me take the second one first. So we actually, in Toronto, I'll speak about our Toronto non-specialist providers. We actually have a pretty diverse group of individuals who come from ethnicity, from various ethnic backgrounds. So of our 8 non-specialists, I would say 4 would identify as non-white, if I can use that term, and 4 are white. And I think in the US, the stats are a little bit higher in terms of it's not as equal. And so this most in future, as when we recruit, we really recruit people for their interpersonal skills and their passion toward maternal mental health. Obviously, they can have no background, no formal training in mental health care. So that's basically the foundation. But I think that it's really, really important that we highlight these issues. It's certainly something that's discussed during supervision. And we've had a lot of diversity talks as well that are available for both our specialist providers as well as our non-specialist providers. And, you know, we have one of the world's leading experts as the moderator on that topic. So we're really lucky that we can discuss these things during supervision and that it is certainly that something that is addressed full on as opposed to something that's shoved under the rug.
Wonderful. We had a shorter question related to the role of social workers. So when you mentioned the need for policymakers in your design and all steps of the project, right, from conceptualization to dissemination, how you think of the problem and share the problem, we had several policymakers say, we're here. But then someone else said, what about the social workers? So what are the different provider backgrounds?
So first of all, it was a huge omission on my part not to say anything about social workers. Social workers play a critical role in this study. Again, and speaking from both the US context and the Canadian context, so frequently the social worker acts as the champion for promoting the study in OB clinics, for sending us potential participants who may be eligible and interested in the study. So my apologies, I forgot to mention social work, and we do have a few social workers on our team. They are also more formally part of the team beyond stakeholders as providers. So not necessarily in Canada, where our specialist providers include psychiatrists and psychologists, but certainly in the US, we do have a few social workers who are part of the specialist provider group that make up that delivery agent.
The exciting thing about this webinar today is the interest and enthusiasm about getting involved for participants. We have one group called Melanated Moms who says, you know, we're doing similar work for life with a baby. How do we get started? Claire, perhaps you could speak to that, strategies for getting involved and getting started. Maybe you're running a community-based organization or not-for-profit. How do you make that bridge? And then Courtney Clyatt as well, if you could speak to steps for getting involved that aren't maybe researcher down, but more organic, community forward. As I mentioned, we were P2P recipients, so we started with a small group and our group continued to grow. So two questions for both of you that are related to how does one get involved?
Okay, so I'll start with the life with the baby. So like I said, initially it was starting a group and posting it online. I actually used a meetup group at first before I started our website. I try not to, for groups, I prefer not to use Facebook. If you're starting a support group, I would, and you don't have your own website, I would go towards a meetup group just because of the some of the additional stressors and anxiety that parents may feel through Facebook groups. And, you know, like I would just go for it. Whatever, like write down, I guess, some community agencies in your area that you may want to collaborate with. See if maybe they're running some programs that you can work together on. In the beginning, one of the things that worked really well for us was working with public health units who they had the program, they had the funding, but they couldn't get the moms to them. But because we were a community agency without the social service stigma attached to it, we would get the group together and then we would get the professionals to come out and present to our group. So there's lots of different ways to do it. And I'm always happy to help another community agency grow. So feel free to reach out to me. I'll put my email in the chat. And if you're interested, we also run, we work with some community agencies in the States. So we run peer groups, like a focused on Canada primarily, but you can also, if you run programs and you wanna reach more moms and you wanna get the message to them of your program, we're always happy to post your program on our website and then send it out so more moms can get connected to you as well. So
I'll put my information. Thanks for saying that. We've got Jay Wilson from Melanated Mom says, we've got 6,000 moms and we're ready. So they'd like to connect directly with you.
Awesome.
Yeah. Thank you. And then Courtney, before you complete your response, we also had a follow-up question in the chat box. It relates to it. Were you able to see the question?
And I think I can address it as well.
All right. Thanks.
So I was writing down my response to make sure that I covered all the points. So how does one get involved? Well, for one thing, and in my slides, I did provide a link to our ambassadors program. And that program is basically like an extension of PCORI to a certain degree. There, it's a group of people who are, they've in a sense drank the Kool-Aid when it comes to patient-centered outcomes research. They believe in it and they believe in ensuring that that patient voice and that stakeholder voice is a part of research funding. So with that being said, joining the ambassador program, serving as an ambassador could be one way of getting involved. And Additionally, we do have the merit review panel, and Karen, perhaps, I don't know if you have time, but you could speak a little bit to that because you've served as a merit review panelist. And Claire, I think you mentioned in your presentation that PCORI does believe that patients are experts on their lived experiences. And so with our merit review panel, we do include scientists as well as patients who can make the decision of whether or not a project idea or a project proposal then gets funded. Additionally, we have our advisory panels. And so our advisory panels help to direct and guide and provide some guidance for our program funded areas. And all of those things, so the merit review, the ambassador program, as well as the panel information can be found in my slides. There's a link to reading more about that. And then also, Karen, you mentioned the pipeline and proposal program and how that was the initial funding that this group received. And with that program, there was an opportunity for patients, like one single patient, to then get funding if they had a meritorious project idea. And then that one single patient would then receive a fiscal agent who would help to direct them in the steps to then developing research partnerships. So while the P2P program is no longer around at PCORI, there is Eugene Washington PCORI Engagement Awards. And so if there are like a group or groups of folks who have themselves established with a tax ID, they would be available to apply to PCORI for funding for the Eugene Washington PCORI Engagement Awards. And under that, that funding mechanism, we have the opportunities for folks to submit applications for capacity building, for stakeholder convenings like this one, and then also to disseminate information to communities that they're attached to. So there are additional ways to get involved with PCORI. If there are any groups here that are looking for tools for engaging communities, we do have our tools and resources repository that can be found on our website. Also, there's a link in my slides. So I encapsulated all of these links in the slides just to be conscious of time and to make sure that, you know, hopefully you'll have some homework on your own so that, you know, after you leave today, you can go and click onto the PCORI website for additional information if you are interested. The other question was in relation to ethnic minorities I think there was a religious or ethnic minority populations in them being the focus of the study. So yes, one of PCORI's national priorities includes addressing or eliminating disparities in health and healthcare across the US. We do have that as a funding stream. If the person who asked that question is interested in learning more, there's information on our website, PCORI.org/topics/addressing-disparities to learn more about that funding under the Science Research Awards. But overall, you know, the idea is to address any issues to ensure that the disparity that is seen within that population is then brought to light. And as long as you can, you know, make sure that you have the historical information about that disproportionate healthcare burden, then you can certainly consider applying to that area. But if you're not yet ready for research, consider the Eugene Washington PCORI Engagement Awards, which would allow you either as a researcher or as a support group or patient group, one that is associated with a tax ID number, to then apply for PCORI funding.
We have one more question for you, Courtney, and it's related to upcoming PCORI funding for maternal health projects.
Sure.
Are there any current or upcoming?
Okay. So I think we just actually had a cycle close on October 1st. So I would say in the new year, there should be additional opportunities specifically for maternal health, maternal mortality. As I mentioned, that is one of our new national priorities. So there definitely will be some great opportunities, whether or not that will be called out directly in funding announcements. I'm not 100% sure, but there will at least be a special emphasis on projects that come to PCORI related to maternal mortality, as well as intellectual and developmental disabilities.
Excellent. Well, the questions have quieted, and we still have nearly 100 people in attendance. I would like to transition slightly for the remaining 15 minutes. We have several of our esteemed patient and provider colleagues on the call, and we'd like to have an informal discussion with you all in reaction to this presentation. Maybe anything that you might be wondering, maybe you wanted to hear about the patient experience, similar to Claire's, similar to researchers that say this work doesn't make sense in a vacuum. We need a broader perspective to find solutions that work. Any of these situations that come up, I would invite you to stay on for the next 15 minutes, and I'm going to ask all of our panelists, our patient partners and providers, to please turn on your cameras to join this call. Thank you again so much to Daisy and Claire and Courtney. This was wildly successful. We learned so much about both the importance and the process of the summit trial and the work of PCORI moving forward. So please stay if you can. This is an informal discussion, and we will be sharing the links to the slides and recordings in the coming week. Thank you for attending, and stay if you can. So my question for you all is if you could state your name and your role and share why you became involved in patient-centered outcomes research. So many of us are involved through two different advisory boards in Illinois and Iowa. We have members from Illinois and Iowa on the call today. And for the past 2 years, we've built patient-centered advisory boards that conduct health fairs, have coffee hours, and we've even designed research studies together and conducted pilot studies where we try and find the best ways to identify women in need of care experiencing depression, anxiety, and stress during pregnancy and the postpartum. Working alongside patients, we have more robust research than when it was just me, myself. So Kelly Rickman is the co-leader of this project, David Huang, a bunch of researchers sitting around just doesn't get the job done. So many of you have joined. If you could please share your name, your role, and why you became involved in this work.
I'll go. My name is Megan Kirkpatrick, and I'm a patient. Very similar to Claire, I had my first child and struggled with some postpartum anxiety and postpartum depression. In not as much of a similar way, I had experienced some of those things before, and so I kind of knew that I needed to quickly get myself some mental health help. But I can't, Claire, what you put out was that is so true is about the need for a support network and the need to have a community of moms to support you through that time with a new baby. And luckily I got connected with a group here in Champaign. I was brand new to the town. I just moved here and didn't know anybody. And I had a baby and I was like, oh my gosh, what am I doing? And then I did meet Karen through different baby mom groups. And when she said there was an opportunity to share my thoughts as a patient and engage in research, that seemed like a really interesting avenue to continue, like you said, helping and try to help other moms. So that was what brought me to I guess we're now Perinatal Connect.
Thank you, Megan. Anyone else care to share?
I will.
Okay.
I'm Sheila Rea. I'm a registered nurse and I function as a family case manager at Public Health here in Champaign. I have two children and I can't say that I would definitely suffer from depression. I just remember feeling really isolated both times, and there's 13 years between the ages of my children, and I experienced the same thing. But I worked as a psychiatric nurse years ago with children from 3 to 10. A lot of the children were DCFS wards, many children of color, most of them from low-income families. These were behavior-disordered children. And I saw the things that the families were up against that for most of the children that didn't have an underlying health condition that led them to be there. It was the pressure that the family was under, the inability of parents to parent. I came to public health and I work with low-income moms, a diverse population, women of color, women of different ethnic backgrounds, but the one thing they have in common is they're all low-income. And I'm seeing the same kinds of pressures. Low-income women and, what can I say, disadvantaged groups have to deal with things beyond even what I experienced, and it's very difficult for them. We started depression screening a number of years ago, and we were seeing high scores and no place to send them. Most of our moms are on Medicaid. There are very few providers in this area as far that provide psychotherapy or anything beyond medication for the moms. So I'm really excited to see, to be a part of a project that's building awareness and maybe changing the way that we look at, maternal health, mood disorders, and how it affects everybody, of all social classes. So I'm thrilled to be here.
Thank you, Sheila. Anyone care to go next? Emily or Ruby, share your motivation. If not, I can read from the chat box.
I can go. Oh, I'm sorry, Ruby.
No, go ahead, Emily.
Okay, thanks, Ruby. I joined the group because I myself experienced postpartum depression and anxiety. And one of the things I really love about our group is that just by working weekly together and making progress and breaking silence, I feel like it's kind of helping me heal through this like long-term trauma that I've experienced. And just knowing that I'm not going through it alone, I don't know if it's okay. Megan and I go to church together, but we probably would have never told about our postpartum stories, And it's just kind of nice to break that barrier and make really dear friends through this. I had a great pregnancy too, and my husband and I have had fertility problems, and we waited so long to have our son, and it was a lot of work. And so by the time he arrived, I couldn't imagine that I wouldn't be anything more than excited to meet him because we had worked so hard and waited so long. But I had a really traumatic birth, and I also went through the child welfare system and had some abuse when I was a child. And I was really shocked at how the labor and delivery, the body just remembers that trauma, and it just, using my body for someone else, and it was kind of all the reproductive parts, and it just was really traumatizing for me, brought up a lot of stuff. And my mom is also super judgy. I could hardly stand her post-maternity. She was like telling me I needed to work on my motherly instincts and stuff like that. So I was pretty secretive about my postpartum depression. So it just feels great to be part of this group and to have made such good friends from the group and to know that we're doing good work and expanding. And that's my motivation for joining and for hopefully staying for a long time. I've really enjoyed it.
Thank you so much for sharing your story, Emily. All of the stories today have been moving. I would like to read one from the chat. We have Jay Wilson. It says, prior to starting my organization, I worked full-time for 10 years as a community health nurse at a community health center that served PCMH for equitable health care, but no focus on maternal health. Personally, I am a four-time survivor of preeclampsia, so I wanted to find a way to bridge my work as a nurse and find my need as a mother to start an advocacy network that was diverse, inclusive, and equitable. When I couldn't find one, I started my own. We've grown immensely in the past 3 years. So thank you so much for sharing that, Jay. I should ask you actually to turn on your microphone if you're still with us and anything to add, because we're so happy that you're here. So Jay, your microphone is on now. We're so happy you're here. Do you have
Hello?
Hi.
Oh, hi. That's kind of weird. Sorry. Can't see anything. Hi, everybody.
Any interest? We're just so happy that you're here on this topic. And yes. In your organization, do you have interest in research projects or doing investigations to study the topic more?
Yes. So I do a lot of work with several organizations. I work with the Preeclampsia Foundation. I also work here in the state of New Jersey with the governor and the first lady on the research for creating more equitable spaces for Black and brown moms to have positive birthing outcomes. Who else do I work for? I do a lot of work in racial diversity. I just recently joined the racial equity task force with the International Association of Women. And it's another one. I don't know. I just do a lot of work around DEI and maternal health and reproductive justice. Prior to COVID, I was really excited to be able to go to Washington when the Momnibus, for the Momnibus reception, when they were signing the different bills for Black maternal health. So I have a huge interest in that. I actually received a resolution from the state of New Jersey for my work here. To create equitable spaces for moms and women. I do a lot of focus groups as well as group facilitation just in general for different moms of color across the melanated spectrum. So not just Black moms, but moms from any type of diverse backgrounds. And you know, it all really started from just learning how to share my personal story and how to grow from it. And not feeling like I was isolated in the incidents that I went through. So I looked at it more as a motivation as opposed to, you know, just a negative experience. And I've been really, really fortunate enough to meet wonderful people like you guys. I don't even know who sent me this webinar, but I was like, I'm going. I'm really very grateful to be able to connect with women who are doing this work. Oh, I also work with the Women's Network of something. I just did a training with them through New Jersey Coalition to End Domestic Violence, the Women of Color Task Force. So we did a lot of work, again, on just creating more equitable spaces for moms and talking about how to break barriers and bridge the gaps in their personal care for themselves, as well as how to become better versions of themselves for their children and as moms, you know, to feel more proud in their motherhood. So I love to have any type of opportunity to talk and work with other moms, women, and organizations that are doing the same work. So I'm just incredibly passionate about it.
Jay, what a wonderful way to end our session. everything you're doing makes me and the others, we're in the same room, it makes us tired.
I'm sorry.
the work that you're doing is very inspiring, and just thank you so much for joining and reaching out. This is a start of making sure that we keep the conversation going, even though we're trapped at home virtual during COVID.
Yeah, sucks.
We want to keep this momentum going and keep convening, keep talking, keep making shift happen, as our partners say. Please help us spread the word. next week, 4 p.m. Eastern, Thursday. We'll be having part two of this series. We'll be talking about maternal mortality and morbidity, maternal sickness and death, which shouldn't be happening at the numbers that it is in the U.S., if at all. Please fill out the evaluation forms. Please return. We look forward to continuing to work with all of you. And thank you so much for attending.